evening. Very happy to recognize and congratulate music teacher Victoria Mazzanora and the CHS Festival Choir for being invited to perform in the National Memorial Day Choral Festival on May 27th. Festival took place in Dowd Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts in Washington, D.C., and Teterboro was one of only two high school choirs to receive this honor. So included in this group of outstanding students are, for soprano, Maddie Adams, Natalie Batsko, Samantha Carlson, Carly Rischel, Samantha Crevenston, Anna Dasso, Kelly Dillaboo, Lauren Eckert, Emily Friedel, Contessa Gansky, Catherine Gwitt, Chloe Herbrand, Juliana Larscheid, Michaela Leach, Lily Leach, Marguerite Mikulitz, Katie Lipianka, Caitlin Miller, Rachel Nault, Abby Patrick, Alexandra Strobach, Sarah Tews. For alto, we have Lily Engelbrecht, Teresa Hartman, Mackenzie Newman, Kendra Finnegar, Cora Cork, Leah Rischel, Emily Rush, Katie Schimp, and Sydney Schutte. For tenor, we have Ethan Haworth, Tevin McComas, and Nathan Wegner, baritone Benjamin Reglin and Will Zakowski, and finally, last but not least, but bass, Nathan Collin. So all those students performed on Memorial Day and represented Teterboro High School extremely well in that presentation, that performance.
Excellent. Thank you. All right, moving right along to the consent agenda.
Board members, I ask that you approve the consent agenda. The first minutes from the May 17th, the 2017 board meeting. The second, the finance information, including summary of accounts, the check register, check detail, and credit card transaction report. And the third item on the consent agenda is the personnel report. And I'll ask that kind of give you a brief update on that.
Thank you. As you can see from the personnel report, we've had a lot of activity over the last month or so. I'll start with the classified sports staff. We've recently added to the team David Wyatt as a help desk support person and Patrick Coster as our district groundskeeper. We have four separations from our support staff: Rick Barber, Katie Cogwallader, Susan Grosskopf, and Elizabeth Gutman, paras and aides and maintenance employees. We've had a number of teacher resignations. Brian Hartwig, Special Education at CHS, Abby Bordick-Rayflaw, Music Teacher at Webster, Jessica Noce, Special Education Teacher at Webster, Dave Pentek, Athletic Director at the high school, Jamie Hennigan, Special Education Teacher at Thorson, Don Rosewitz, Special Education Teacher at the high school, Tamara Sneed, First Grade Teacher at Westlawn, Kate Blaine, Physical Education Teacher at the high school, Michael Hendricks, Math Teacher at the high school, Joy Conway, Special Education Teacher at the high school, Wendy Springer, English Teacher at the high school, and Kelly Locke, Second Grade Teacher at Westlawn. Going a long way to replace many of those vacancies, we ask contract approval for Aaron Staffaroni, First Grade at Thorson, Claire Toko, Third Grade at Thorson, Kayla Bailey, Special Education at Thorson, Caitlin O'Mar, Social Studies, Jessica Pagel, Guidance Counselor, Darwin Peters, Special Education, Benjamin Coltis, Special Education, Michelle Coots, Business Education, and Ellie Retzky, Math Teacher, all at the high school. And then Mackenzie Clapper, Special Education, Robin Carpenter, First Grade Teacher, and Corey Bolden, Fifth Grade Teacher, all at Westlawn. And we'd ask that you approve those teacher resignations and contracts.
Move to approve the consent agenda.
I'll second that.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Against? Motion carries.
It's just a side note, it's great to see several Cedar Group graduates coming back.
Quite a few.
Employed by the district, so it's great that there's college here from that. It's good to see some people.
It's also good to see all the applicants. Mm-hmm. All right, well, moving right along, tech ed presentation now.
So this will be a PowerPoint. Some gentlemen, board members, if you'd like to see the audience, and you can watch it from your seats. This evening, I'd like to, before I get started, just recognize we have a few committee members that helped in the partnership of doing this tech ed program with you and our audience. If I call you in, if you don't mind standing, I'd like to recognize you, Joe Rimmelman, Alvin Springman, Aaron Dank, Adam Kirk, Rachel Yerk, Ted Kinole, Luke Lechner. Is this anybody? Josh. Wankowski. Great. Other round of applause for you. Tech Ed program review. So tonight is an update for the board and the community, those of you watching at home. A goal that was established at the start of the school year to do a full Tech Ed program review. So the outline tonight for tonight's presentation are just four parts to give you an overview of the foundation that we went through, talk about the team structure, how and what kind of research we looked at for our ultimate recommendations that we're going to share with you. Foundation building. So this is the goal: conduct a program review of K-12 technology, engineering, and develop recommendations for future development. And this is when you think about a goal like this, this is really all about student learning and engagement. So it's linked to that pillar. It's really helping the district vision out what makes sense for our students, what are they currently taking in our district, what are the current needs of our students, what does the job outlook look like, what are the future trends that we are seeing, and trying to come around that and eventually make some recommendations that we're going to show you at the end of the presentation tonight. So it is the plan and the Plan Do Study Act. So it's really that diving deep, really doing a thorough job so that we can come to a place tonight where we can make some solid recommendations for the school system, ultimately to impact student learning. That's the CPR card. All items are completed as of tonight. One item, just looking at potentially there could be some jobs on the horizon or courses that might require some additional training. We recognize that as we did some of the planning. We're not ready to work on that piece yet, so it's still marked as yellow. It'll be something that we put into the three-year plan. Linked to our mission, so this is really all about providing exemplary education. So this particular area, just Tech Ed, so your autos, woods, metals, and when we did our research, it reached into science, it reached into arts, and it reached into mathematics and computer science. So all things STEAM, if you will. So it's really about helping us as a school system provide the very best for our kids, really on the path to a premier school district. So there are some recommendations tonight that we believe puts us further on the path towards being a more premier school district, which we're really excited about. And of course, the team, as a team, I think we would collectively say, even at our last evening, it was about dreaming big and not withholding what we believe were best for the system. So the recommendations are robust, and they are outstretched out over multiple years, but we believe that these are the right next steps for us. So our team structure gives you an overview. If I just draw your attention to the right side where it shows beliefs. So this really was a great example of belief, of the district's belief of working with community in action. So your community members, you had students, you had staff, and you had district administration all working together around this particular goal. So it gives you roughly 25 people on this team. This gives you a profile, so you have lots of, and really appreciative of the time invested in this work. So this is over a 3-month span, people left with homework assignments, things that they had to read, come back and discuss. So you'll see there are people with background experiences that really brought a lot to the discussion. So really appreciative of all that knowledge that was in addition to our research with us. We also have a lot of district staff, so you saw some of them here this evening, and then also other teachers not represented here tonight, but we had everyone from every department that was being looked at present. And we have 4 students, which was awesome. Great to have their voice. They're our customers, so we really want to know what our students think. We had an alum back, Aaron Dank. Which is awesome, just someone that's gone through our system, and now as we're looking, casting enough forward and thinking about the future of our Tech Ed program and things related to STEM or STEAM, it was nice to hear his voice at the table. So all the students, it's just a great ad. Here we are as a group. So now I'm going to talk about research findings. So a lot of different kinds of research we looked at. We looked at our Cedarburg, different kinds of enrollment data. We looked at some workforce needs. We did a deeper dive on engineering and just looking at overall engineering. What does the research say? We did some district visits. You'll see some photos of that. We broke our work up into 4 groups. You'll see them down the right side. So all those team members, roughly 25 people, divided up into smaller groups. Ted had the lead for one. I had the lead for one. Rachel had the lead for one. And Adam had the lead for one. So then when we met as a group, we would often work together for a bit and then disperse, do more work, and then come back together. So it really helped us to efficiently work through the work. The overall research is really segmented into four areas. So when you see the recommendations tonight, they're gonna talk a bit about vision, about professional development, facilities, and course design. So as we were doing our research, we kept thinking about these four areas and lining up our findings around them, and eventually the recommendations got fleshed out. Nice historical perspective regarding if we look at tech ed in the purest form. So if you look at history over 100 years, tech ed has gotten itself branded in many different kinds of ways throughout history here in the US. So going back to 1900,
you want to talk about that?
Yeah,
I can before your time. But you'll see, just for the sake of looking at time and some of the different labels that have come around, the woods, metals, automobile, manufacturing, industrial arts, the career tech ed, vocational education, merging into STEM, and then STEAM. Not placed deliberately on the timeline because sometimes these things stretch or overlap, but it shows you that these initiatives taking place in our country, and really, if you will, branding tech education, was really about, again, doing whatever it takes to help our kids be successful when they leave the high school. So whatever career path they're on, high school is really thinking about what can we offer inside the school to prepare those students for their future. Here's some graduating student profile data so you can see where our students are headed. The majority are into a four-year college, some to two-year, a few into the military, which we really greatly appreciate, and a few others into employment or other. So it's important to get a slice of the demographic of our community, and this data is rather, if you look over a couple of years, somewhat stable. So this is the trend for our community and our families' children. Start diving into data by gender. So a lot of research talked about this, so then it caused us to reach out to Michelle Mock and actually start extracting out data by gender. So if you look at some of the areas that we looked at, computer science, Project Lead the Way, you'll see the enrollment by boys and girls. And one thing we noticed, of course, is the higher enrollment for boys and lesser enrollment for girls. Total enrollment by department. So if we look at the departments as a whole and we cluster their classes together, total enrollment for this past school year is as it shows there. So some in auto, some in metals, a lot in the arts, and some in woods. So we did recognize that in some of our tech ed courses, just some lower enrollment, kids interested, but not to the degree that we're seeing in other departments. On our horizon right now, Wisconsin is looking at updating their science standards. They're long overdue, and many districts in the state of Wisconsin and throughout the country have adopted the next generation science standards, which now include a new strand, engineering design. So this is very important because it's shaping the new standards for Wisconsin. So we've already started looking at them in the school system. I'm working with Webster teachers this summer in grade 6 through 8 science. So this strand is a new strand that's not actually deliberately taught in our courses, in our science courses. So that's new content for us. So the tech ed program review team, when you see this, then now you go, okay, so that's actually going to shape some of the courses and some of the unit adjustments that students receive in our school system. College and career and work ready, something that we're very focused on. It's part of us partnering with families in the community, helping students to exit the system as successful as possible. 21st century skills came out around the turn at around 2000. So you'll see different kinds of characteristics that the think tank that developed those said that the workforce needs these. For students to be successful in the workforce, you need these. Engineering practices now are the next layer. I put some in red just to show you the distinguishing difference. So the engineering practices systems thinking. And I was even thinking, it's not just when you think of an engineer, it can be even intellectual or cognitive engineering. So it's just understanding how systems work and teaching kids how systems work. Optimism was another area, and then ethical considerations. So there's a distinct difference, similarity and difference between the 21st century skills and the engineering practices, but both sets of these are characteristics of what we want for all students. So whether or not you're an engineer or not, the set on the left are also practices or behaviors we want to see embedded within our students' skill set as they leave high school. This cycle was, in the research, made referenced multiple times in a resource that was recommended to us to look at. And it just shows the distinguishing differences between the scientific process versus the engineering design cycle. So as we start to think about developing new courses, introducing new units around engineering, being mindful of constraints, something that's really important in engineering, and trade-offs. So there's a specific model that we use, and so we're already starting to tinker with this at one of our schools who received the CEF grant in teaching the engineering cycle to students. So it'd be distinctively different, and we want students to be able to recognize the differences between the two. We also recognize that there are workforce shifts occurring. So American engineering workforce is very low when it comes to gender. We'll see it on the next slide. U.S. Census projects by 2050, minorities will make up almost half of the U.S. population. This is the current proportion of employed engineers by segmented group. 11% women, 3.1% African Americans, 5% Hispanics, 0.3% Native Americans. When they look internationally at the workforce, and because we're such a global work system, and you can work and live, you can work for a company in America and live in a far-off land, we have to be mindful of what's going on in the world. So looking at future engineers, the data is now saying that China's workforce, the number of kids graduating with a degree has doubled. India's has doubled, and the US's have gone up by 20%. So they're starting to see the shift that the workforce here in this country is actually moving at a slower rate than it is in other countries. Things like the National Academy of Engineering has already put forth their 14 grand challenges. I just draw your attention to a few, showing that on the horizon for our children are being able to tackle things like this. So for some of them, this is going to be a place where they're going to actually be in the workforce working on. But you can see there are many, and this is just, that's just 3 of 14 major global challenges that we need an educated workforce to be able to tackle. We also asked the students, so we did a survey, brief, it lasted only, we had the window open for roughly about 4 days. About a fourth of the high school seniors quickly responded. We asked them a few questions. One of them, I just showed you this evening, which elective courses do you rank the highest? So these are choice. So you can see music, faith, social studies, science, bi-ed, engineering, business, and art came to the surface. So they listed lots of courses, pages of them. Most of the courses fell into these departments. So again, just thinking about the customer, what kinds of elective courses do you like, where you take them, and we noticed that most of them fell into those areas. So again, as you're collecting all this information in your mind tonight, you can just see that we're trying to pull information out of research, out of the profile of our students, and what the future looks like for them to eventually lead us to the recommendations at the end. So tonight, each of the team leads are going to speak to their individual slide as it relates to the area that they worked on. So I'm going to invite Adam up to talk about the autos and engineering findings.
And the privilege of working with a very efficient and effective group worked really well together to dig deep into what we saw and a lot of the visits and to look at the research and what the data is saying currently, and came up with these four kind of standards for any movement forward here at Cedar Brook High School. And the first and the most obvious was higher level application of auto standards. So within our autos classes, you learn how to change oil, you learn how to replace brakes and tires, but how do we make that more efficient? How do we make the brakes lighter and last longer? And probably the most common kind of identifiable piece at schools that we saw nowadays are the high mileage cars. It's a competition. It started as a college competition. It's worked its way down into high schools in which you are creating a high mileage car to get 1, 2, 3, up to 500 miles over some of the high schools around here per gallon for a car. And so those were groups that were formed through the autos program to really apply what they're learning at a higher level. How do you make your brakes more efficient? How do you make your car lighter? How do you design a different frame to engage in that? And so to do that, you look at our second bullet point, which is facilities and maximize integration. It's no longer just an autos room, a metals room, a woods room. Many of the schools that you see integrate all of those into one large area where students can work together and collaborate so that a student who has an interest in designing the engine piece can work with a student who is interested in the engineering piece to design this car. And it's most efficient manner, and then the student who has an interest in the engine, or the brakes, or the tires, or the tangible items there can design and make it, and they can work together to build it. So a facility with a lot of open space in order to collaborate, plan, design, was what was viewed at a lot of the schools as being a really effective piece to move their departments forward. Courses that incorporate engineering and design best practices kind of along those same lines, where we need to make that that area inviting to all different areas. You saw the timeline and continuum where it used to just be a single piece, and now it's STEAM, which includes arts, art for the design, math to calculate the most efficiency you can get out of a piece. So a lot of different pieces can work together now, and that's kind of the modern movement for the higher level practices of an autos and engineering courses. And then the last and probably most important piece is the partnerships are essential. What came out of our group was, and all of the groups I believe at the end of it, was to form kind of an advisory team to help support all of this. People who are in the business right now, community members who have some skin in the game and can guide our students to what they're seeing in the workplace after they would leave school, and to guide our design here at the school so that it moves forward in the right direction from there.
Thank you, Adam. All right, art, metals, and wood binding. Is Ted.
We've had the pleasure of looking at three distinct, separate areas, but as we studied them closely, we realized that some very interesting things about them were similar. One of the things we thought most interesting was a lot of students took these courses as an intro, take one course, but they didn't typically go on beyond that. And one of the things that was interesting about that is that a lot of students said they had a purpose around those. I mean, I think with the left to fill up my schedule, but I didn't see a purpose beyond that. So that's where the integration of course concepts becomes really important, because so that purpose was, you know, leading to something else within the curriculum or a career or some type of a certificate later would be much more beneficial, much more interesting for students to think about. Instead of just rounding out a course in arts or metals or woods, we found the arts courses in our study more popular than the metals and woods. But then again, as we dug into what the course content was, some of that was not applicable to a lot of the things that students do nowadays with further studies at the post-secondary level. So that was a huge piece of our findings as it fits into the STEM and STEAM process of how districts are aligning their curriculums. Course projects and assignments emphasize theory and real-life application. Our students around the country and the world are finding more need to see it tied into something. Why am I doing this other than to course? Where are these paths leading to? And then student-driven learning increases engagement. So the more they own the course content and can see those integrations, the more likely they are to take them further. One of the things that we also talk a lot about too is some of the students who take some of these courses aren't those that would lead to higher level study as well. So kind of that, okay, let students who want to advance their learning may take another path instead of some of these specific courses. So one of the courses that was brought forward, Sculpture in Allen, where they're integrating many of these content areas, arts, metals, woods, and other things in their well-being to start to create these courses where they're starting to integrate across disciplines and use different spaces, just like Adam talked about with integrating spaces.
Some board members who remember the sculpture course would have been a course you approved for 2018-19. So we're already looking at that course being located in perhaps the metals area. So part could be done maybe in their art class, and part for the welding could be done there. So that's where that integration comes in, where we're not just in an art room only. We need other things to develop these projects. And now I'm going to turn it over to Rachel, Team 3 Innovation Apprenticeships and Co-Curricular Findings.
This team had a unique challenge in that we were looking at just certain curricular areas. probation, apprenticeships, co-curricular, and all of that, kind of have hands into all of the areas of STEAM and looking at all of the curriculum and how do we do that. And as we did that, the site visits became really helpful to members of our team who got out and looked around, found out what other people are doing. We know what we're doing. We can see it on paper. We did look into the statistics, as Alan mentioned earlier, how many kids are involved in different things that we offer. But we came up with these three main focus areas. So, and you'll notice maybe, just based on the other two teams, some of these things have already been said in different ways because there's a lot of overlap here. So we're talking also about student personalizing student-directed opportunities. So that's things like project-based learning. You heard, I think Adam started with that, and I think even Ted said that too, making things into more of a project-based so it's not an isolated learning experience. Talking about the vehicles and how you create those things as opposed to those isolated opportunities. More online opportunities for students as we look at apprenticeships and co-curricular types of things, what things can they get at online. And all of those things increase student engagement. And that was something Ted mentioned as well. Student engagement is a big piece for all of these kids because these are often self-selected by our students. The second piece is marketing and coordinating ourselves a little bit better. We do have some great internships. We do have some great apprenticeships out there. Many of our kids don't know about them. We don't market them as well as we should be. And when we look at other districts and follow some of their systems for marketing, there's some really great ways to do this. And so just we know that we need to do a better job of not only coordinating what we have, but marketing it out to our students as well as our community to find others, because we have such a diverse community that can offer more to our students. And finally, going down to spaces, when you see some of the images that Alan's going to share with you later today about the places that we went and saw, one of the big things that we noticed is that the location of these places, whether it's art being near Tech Ed, so that those coordinating things that they want to do together can happen right now in our facilities. They're happening across the school from one another. So that coordination and collaboration is not as easy to make happen. Our learning spaces are not what they could be or what we saw as we got out there. So as we look at that interdisciplinary teaching, so many of our different departments coordinating together, we don't do that well. Not as well as what we've seen as we got out about.
So as a core team, so Adam, Ted, Rachel, and I, we would plan every time in between our whole group sessions, even at the original design of the project itself. This particular team is unique. So from a Tech Ed program review, you could say, whoa, innovation. Like, why did you segment this out? Part of it was the rationale that we know that project-based learning and more hands-on learning is an important part to Tech Ed. And so we wanted to see what the current trends are for all things innovation, project-based learning. So Rachel's team did a great job of just digging in, and we made some specific visits to specific districts that have applied this. So we wanted to know, okay, how can we take that, translate that into anything related to engineering, for example. So a really important component to our work. Team four was mind, science, math, computer science findings. So we, based on our research, found that integrating engineering practices in the curriculum is important. Specifically, we know that we require engineering classes in grades 6 and 7. Everything else is elective. So we're going to be, you'll see in the recommendations, have something more forward on how we want to integrate that into our courses. Course features, so the physical location, the content that's taught, encourages engagement and enrollment. Had a pretty compelling conversation with an engineering teacher in another district, and just the physical space, the rebranding of course titles, the course, I think it was like a decorating class. It's a let's just, for lack of a better phrase, it was like a decorating class, but it's an engineering class. And so in there, students were learning about electrical wiring, lighting, all the heating and cooling, plus the design of the space. So they found that their enrollment jumped, so you had more girls actually enrolling in that class because the course was actually rebranded in a different way and other areas were incorporated. So we saw that that made a difference. Arrowhead offers single gender engineering classes. Next year they'll be offering two engineering classes for girls only, full. They're both full. So we had a lot of discussion in our team about that. Would you like that? Would you not like that? I think it's everyone's got a different opinion on that, but you do see districts taking more forward steps on ensuring that we're really providing lots of opportunities for kids and making it accessible and interesting to them. Last couple here, integration of multiple content areas. We saw one district had, it was called a mousetrap car. We do a similar project. They added a mathematical design feature to the requirements. The car couldn't go further than 50 feet. To let it go as far as you wanted, they said it was easy. But as soon as the engineering restriction went to 50, it was really hard. So there's a lot of mathematical thinking and content that was woven into the unit that an engineering teacher perhaps wouldn't have that background knowledge. So having more educators involved in some of these courses will be important. And flexible learning spaces over and over and over again. And I said to Todd, who knows that there's a would be a complimentary presentation that would go with this evening that you're not going to see tonight, but we have lots of photos all prepared to show others just in light of some of the spaces that we saw. So flexibility was really important. These are the districts we visited. Brilliant, Ripon, Kettle Moraine, Arrowhead, Pewaukee, and our own high school. Here's some photos of them. Common teaching and learning characteristics that we saw after visiting them. Whole and small group learning areas, flexible spaces for exploration, collaboration, and application. Learning environment design and tool organization. And notable trademarks. When you walk away, it's like, oh, I'm never going to forget that. And there are these kinds of things that kept reoccurring after each visit. Now, clear, I probably have over 200 slides. Tonight, you're only getting 51, and we're almost at the end of the presentation. So I'm only going to show you a few photos. Okay. Whole and small group learning areas. Brilliance Engineering Center on the left. They took a gymnasium, they completely rebuilt it strictly for engineering. One of their first priorities was to create spark. Really get kids excited about the whole, all the practices of engineering. I heard a presentation from an engineering teacher who's an elementary teacher in Sun Prairie. He said a lot of kids shy away from engineering because they have preconceived notions about what makes an engineer. And he really said, we've got to break those myths. It's about helping people. So you can just replay all the different kinds of things that are designed and made are about helping people. So Brilliant took a real bold step to really create a lot of spark and excitement around engineering. And then they developed a whole layer of engineering units that they teach all elementary students. In this particular day when we visited, there were three classrooms in that one space. It's double-decker, lots of features, and I have a lot more photos to show you. Not tonight. Second photo on the right-hand side is Kettle Moraine Global. So this was very common for their spaces. They always had breakout sessions. So the small little areas where groups of students can come together. So here we have a group, actually a student, I think in the far corner by the screen, is giving a presentation to a group of students on a topic that they signed up to listen to. So we won't talk about the nature of the global learning high school in Kettle Moraine, but this was very common to create spaces where kids have some flexibility they can go to. There are glass walls so teachers can see into these spaces. So it was just a nice blend of whole and small group learning, and it replayed itself district after district after district. Flexible spaces. This is Ripon High School, completely remodeled. It's a 612 facility. This was also very common. Glass walls everywhere, every classroom. Very rarely did you see a classroom with a wall and a hallway that was drywall. It was almost always glass, you could see right out. And they built these little areas where students could work. We went through this space multiple times because we wanted to see the science labs. And this conference room right here, which you would think would be used by teachers, the next time we came here, it was a group of students working on a project together. So these flexible spaces where kids can work in or can work out was another feature that we saw throughout all of the buildings. Learning environment design and tool organization. On the left is Arrowhead's engineering wing. You'll notice lots of features here. A lot of equipment in a lot of these spaces are on wheels. They're flexible, they can move around. Brightly lit, polished floors, incredibly organized, immaculate. strong belief at Arrowhead that students, if you're going to be an engineer, or you're going to design something, it's one thing to put it on paper and create it. It's another to go over and build it. So they create very high-tech facility spaces for kids to be designers, work, create. Now let's go across the hall and give it a try and see how it goes. And so they showed us projects that they gave them a lot of latitude on that actually backfired, and just really putting them in the role of engineers, boys and girls. So we saw blended classrooms, and they have single gender classrooms as well. The space on the right is the engineering lab for teachers to use at Brilliant. So this is set up strictly just for all the engineering lessons that they teach. Everything that they need, all the tools, all the design features are all located here. Plus, there's another breakout space for them to do more design work before they even go into the classroom. So some really nice features to that science wing that are engineering wing that they put onto the elementary school. Notable trademarks, so I just highlighted here for you Arrowhead High School. So this is their Design Engineering Manufacturing Center. It's a brand new wing. A lot of donors went into it. A couple things that you'll notice. First, it's very forward facing. Like you come into this wing, you see that front wall on the left hand side. It really just makes it pop and stand out. The hallway's brightly lit, lots of cam lighting, lots of glass walls. The more you go down there, you'll see more and more glass walls. They used a place called Maverick in Delafield to help them with even some of their design qualities in the rooms. Full white walls, tables, everything rolls and moves. Kids come in here and they sketch and they design in teams, and then again, that's the Arrowhead way. Then they take it, they put it onto whatever computer software that they're using, they create the design, and then they go over and they build it. So, just a very impressive space that people would feel like you're in a corporate center right here. On the wall, I've got the image right here, they monitor the energy use of this particular wing of the building. So students are also taught about just all overall engineering practices as it relates to energy conservation. So just notable trademark as we left Arrowhead High School, we won't forget this space. So now we're at our recommendations. We're going to go around these four areas. Facilities. Complete facilities upgrade to include collaborative learning spaces with specific attention made towards the integration and redesign of Cedarbrook High School's tech, ed, and art departments. Develop an oversight team comprised of district, community, and business stakeholders. And this came through every group. Got to have a group to oversee, continue to monitor, develop partnerships with the community and businesses around. We want to help you. We want to be a part of the process. Student learning experiences. Integrate project-based and problem-based learning opportunities within course units. So more attention to what students are doing in the classes, and not specifically, wouldn't necessarily only isolate to engineering, but looking across content areas. Improve marketing awareness and rebranding of tech, ed, and engineering departments to reach all students. So this rebranding has a lot to do with image. So again, Arrowhead, Brilliant, Ripon, Kettlebrain, Pewaukee, these places are very, very cutting edge, very bright. They are welcoming to all kids. So there's a real deliberate action taken to make these spaces, the content that they're learning, how the teacher presents himself or herself, all of that goes together to really draw kids in. So we really saw that this is actually very important. Provide staff professional development in the areas of engineering and project problem-based learning, incorporating collaborative cross-departmental learning opportunities. That's like integrating that math in that mousetrap car. So providing opportunities for teachers, not just to collaborate at their grade level, but to collaborate with other content areas. Number six, identify and develop a 4K through 5 curriculum which teaches engineering design principles through engaging units of study. So we knew that this was something that was Brilliant in particular took some actionable steps, and ironically, I found out this evening that the individual who we met with now has been hired by UAB Green Bay. So that engineering teacher now is going to be working with Green Bay as they develop their new engineering facility at UAB Green Bay. So the units, building, giving kids a strong start in engineering practices, helping them to see it's something that they possibly could do, teaching them the differences between engineering and just the scientific process, and then actually having actual units of study in the area of engineering is something that we feel strongly should be built in a blend right with grade 6, with grade 7, And then students will have choice in grade 8 when they come to high school. There'll be a, we have an entourage of engineering classes that they can take when they get here. So it's giving them a strong start, educating them along the process, and really ultimately equipping them, thinking back to that slide about those engineering characteristics, a systems thinker. So it's something that will benefit all children regardless of the pathway that they choose. So we want to get them on their strong as possible when they exit our system. So we believe these recommendations set them up correctly. So a three-year plan. So these are just some of the items that I've already started to scaffold out over 3 years. Could be an advisory team, could be in a 4K through 12 engineering and design team. This is going to be important because we want to start looking at courses and units that kids are taught. Solidify the plan. Does the plan make sense? Partner with Westmont to develop a makerspace. CEF has already funded a makerspace where kids tinker and design. So Rachel and I have already partnered with them. We're going to do book study together and teach the engineering practices here, because this model could be a model that could be replicated at Thorson and Parkview. Provide additional tech ed program review information to facilities team and the architect that's hired. So we have a ton of photos and other feedback that we could provide. We were, in a sense, also scouts. So while we're out there learning, we're gathering information, so we have a lot to share. Explore the 4K through 5 engineering curriculum. And there are some that this, the National Academy of Engineering, has highly recommended. I've already reached out to Engineering Elementary in Boston. There's Project Lead the Way for Elementary, so we'll look at a couple options. Deploy 4K through 8 engineering practices through PD. So teachers have to be taught what these are. Study and align courses with next-gen science standards. We're starting with 6-8 science this summer. Begin equipment review for CHS Tech Ed. So start look. We were told multiple spots that should go, that should go. There's other professionals that came into the school on our team. There's certain pieces of equipment that should no longer even be here. So we want to start to come up with a plan, start sunsetting some of that equipment, opening up the space, and considering letting the architects do their work as well, and look at the space and how we can make some improvements to that. And then deploy the new sculpture course. So I hope this leaves you with a feeling that we're leaning into the outer margins. That's one of our beliefs. So we just want to move the system forward, continue to press ourselves. Even though it seems like, wow, that's a lot, and how's that all going to get done? It's exciting work. I believe it's the right work and good work for our kids. So I believe that's the Cedar Brook School District way, and we're really excited to be a part of it. I think at our last meeting, Adam did a great job of facilitating a process that listed the priorities, which gave you the 6 recommendations that you saw tonight. And the team overall was really excited and very hopeful, hoping that we could see this come to fruition. So there are a lot of people out there that were on that team that have already said, I'll be in your advisory. So there's a lot of interest. So very exciting times for us. So that concludes our presentation.
Thank you.
Yes.
Questions you made?
You know, I think it's like our work that everyone did. And you know, just walking around the building, looking at the space itself, I think some of those machines were here before the pandemic. So.
That long.
Right. But, I mean, the space is antiquated, you know, it looks like, you know, those areas when I was going to school, I like, you know, when I saw these other schools, the space, you know, I like the fact that you're looking at integrating it from kindergarten all the way up through. I think that would create a better comfort level for all the students when they get here. They're not just smacked in the face with engineering. They know about engineering, right? They're not afraid of it. I like the idea about the gender-specific courses. I think that would lend itself to get more students involved as well. And I'm really looking forward to the next steps. I think really we need to revamp that space. I think it's a waste of space right now, frankly. And I think we can do what we're doing in that space now. We can do a lot more. Mm-hmm. And I like the idea of bringing those two areas close together. I don't know how that would work from an architect standpoint, but really love the work we do.
Yeah, it's exciting. Thank you.
I have a question. One of the first slides shows the percentage of the number of kids that are going to 4-year colleges. Have we ever looked at that and kind of studied it to see how many actually complete 4-year colleges? Just with my own kids looking at their friends, how many of them have gone off to 4-year college, did a year, went to tech school, and went to the workforce? because it kind of skews the look of those numbers in our school of where our kids are ending up. Is there a way that we can study that, reach out? Do we do surveys? Do we do anything like that, that we could get that, extrapolate that data back out and see? Because maybe if we have these facilities and these abilities for them, some are going to decide they don't want to go to 1 or 2 years or 4 year college and then another tech school. They might just want to go there, or, you know, the MSOEs or things like that, because that's where they want to go instead of going to a UW first and then changing their mind.
There's clearinghouse data that we receive annually that does show us. Haven't fully analyzed that, but I heard a presentation this morning, so I was with the English department from Webster and High School at a conference today. So it's all about student engagement in the area of literacy. And overall for the nation, the dropout rate for college students is appalling when we look at it globally. A lot of students are challenged by the curriculum. And one of the areas this presenter said is that the 600 pages of reading required per week for a college student was the current data, and how we need to continue to build stamina for students here when they're under our roof, so that when they're equipped for the workload shift, when they get to the college level. So I think, you know, we're all in this together, mom and dad, the district, student, helping them make as best a choice for themselves as they can. I think sometimes, you know, some kiddos, I was talking to a parent today, she goes, you know, my daughter went here, and she went here, and then she went here, and then she said she wants to be her stylist. She goes, but you know, at the end of the day, I'm really happy. She's happy. That's what she wants to do. So sometimes it takes time. Like, you just can't figure it all out. You just jump in, and then you go, oh, I actually don't like this, and I like something different. But we want to be mindful of that, too.
It'd be nice to see that data.
Sure.
Towards the end, you had a couple slides, goal 3 to goal 6, that we go around on the system. And what did we do? You talked about next steps and things like that, the curriculum sooner. Rather than the thing that stuck out to me is 2017 to 2020. Why can't that be 2017 to 2018 and accomplish these goals to get things done and get classes integrated in the, you know, K-4 to 4K to 5th grade, integrate some modules on this stuff? It doesn't have to be an entire semester of it, or
right.
Maybe a 1 week module in some of these, and get some of these things started. Because if I was a, you know, a freshman parent, I'd say 2020, I can't even graduate by then before you guys get this stuff done. Is there a way to move that faster?
Yeah.
I know it's a ton of work, and overarching the whole thing, you have no quantum at all.
Right.
And it makes sense, logical, you did a good approach, and the team approach is really good. I just want to get it done, so I'm
right.
Move it faster.
The, recommendation made to me was pilot some of the engineers' elementary units, just get into the classroom,
right.
Just try them out.
Pilots, yeah.
So I got to get that team convened, because I want, so what you don't have here today are our classroom teachers who would be teaching this, so it's like I got to deploy what we learned to them, so they have an understanding, and then you have video.
And I talked about a little bit, some of the stuff when we toured the facilities, some of the equipment, things like that, is so outdated, it's not meaningful for students.
Right. Right.
I mean, they're not going to make, you know, something on a sheet of metal anymore, that way of tool and die stuff. It's the engineering and stuff like that. I'd love to see us integrate that and then make it more meaningful for students, too.
Right.
That they learn something, you know, like we talked about on the trip, you know, plumbing stuff, basic plumbing, electrical stuff. There's a lot to learn about that would be meaningful in kids' life. Mm-hmm. Today, I was shocked to see in the news today that Menards and Best Buy and Home Depot are getting sued because a 2x4 is not 2 inches by 4 inches. I mean, I think I learned that when I was 10 years old. It's shocking to me that there's a class action lawsuit over there. And we should be teaching that to kids.
Sure. Right.
So they don't have class action lawsuit over there.
Isn't it shocking to you?
We can teach this. Day to day things that students can learn from. In that area right now, I think we could update that. I'd like to see us get forward with some of that stuff.
Agreed.
Yeah, I just have to say thank you, Alan, for all your work. Thank you to the community members to be a part of that team. When you bring a group of 25 together with that kind of diversity background here, it'll take a while just to corral them and get them focused on a particular target, and you were able to do that in a short period of time. Mind you, this is work that was started, I want to say, in March, as you said. So it usually takes about a year to condense it and got it done in a short period of time. So thank you for all your work and for all the community members that are part of that, students and teachers. It's the right work. It's transformational work. when you talk about that, it's not something that happens overnight. It does take time, but there are certainly pieces that we can get in pepper and get kids and teachers excited about it. And it is all about opportunity when we think about providing opportunity. And to your point, Rick, when we talked a little bit about having that K-14 experience within a K-12 timeline and making certain that kids are exposed to different options so that they begin to have a career pathway before they leave here, so they're not jumping around with different careers and ending here. How can we help them find their passion early? And that's part of what the work we're doing. So thank you again for having us down. Lauren, you'll hear more about it. Yeah.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you very much.
All right, moving on to the Piedmont District enrollment and Section 8.
Don't ask this item, there's an attachment in your board docs, board members.
Yeah, there's a breakdown in board docs of the current enrollment estimate that we're looking at for next year for 17 and 18. The estimate breaks it down by sections, by building, and then average class size in each building. It's all color-coded to kind of point out different areas that we're keeping our eyes on. A couple different items to point out. Areas in green are anything, any class sizes that are below the guidelines. Areas in yellow are within one of the guideline, and then anything in red is above the guideline for what we have for elementary class sizes. The areas that are pink or purple are the five different seats we opened for OE back in January. So those OE numbers include one seat for each of those respective sections. And the areas in blue are different sections that are changing in terms of the number of sections that we have. So you can see in 4K, we're recommending a bump at Parkview and Thorson to maintain class sizes lower in those grades. And then there's a slight switch at West Lawn to accommodate the higher class size that's going to fifth grade. Overall, there's not too many pressure points. The ones that we are aware of, we're addressing with additional staff, whether it be aid or whatnot, to help accommodate the needs there. And the other areas we're keeping an eye on, because obviously it's very early in the season before school actually starts, so these numbers can fluctuate as new students come over the summer and whatnot. So.
Good. I think it's good that you're keeping an eye on it like you usually do. This early in the game, we already budgeted for assistance in those sections that you know are a little higher. So appreciate it. It might change. So and you'll change your tack as well, I'm sure. So thank you for the update.
Yeah, just to note, board members, we did tackle this at the last PNF meeting and we discussed it in detail. So the PNF members have more background.
All right. Moving on to recommendations, donations.
Excellent. We're going to have our consent vote on the donations, but as we did at the last board meeting, it seemed to work out quite well. So I'm asking the board to take action on five donations. The first is a donation of $2,000 from the Wells Fargo Matching Gifts Program. The donation is to use for a breakout space at Webster Transitional Middle School, once we take action tonight, for the 2017-18 school year. The next item I would ask the board to approve is a donation of $5,000 from the Greater Cedarburg Foundation. This donation is used to purchase a trailer for the Cedarburg High School Robotics team for the 17-18 school year. That's exciting. Next item is a donation of $500 from the Fine Arts Boosters. This donation will be used by the Cedarburg High School's Vocal and Music Department for the 17-18 school year. Next item is a donation of $3,105.75 from the Boys and Girls Track Concession sales during the May track meets. This donation will be used by the Boys and Girls track teams for the 2017-18 school year. And the last donation is one of $3,000 from the Al and Sally Kostelic. This donation will be used by the Seabrook High School Family Consumer Science Department for the 17-18 school year. So I ask the board members to approve all five donations.
Move to approve the donations.
Second.
Motion second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Against? Motion carries. Thank you. Action to approve 17-18 meeting calendar.
Sure. Chris, just before we jump off, that's the last meeting of this fiscal year. So just to note the total dollar amount of donation that we received this year, $109,213.71 of donations for our students. Pretty impressive.
Okay, wow.
The next item is the approval of board calendar. Board members, we presented this at the last board meeting, so we fielded a few questions since our last board meeting, so we're asking for approval. After getting your feedback, we made a few adjustments, and it's ready to go.
Does anybody recall the adjustments that were made?
I think we made a couple committee adjustments, maybe added a few B and G.
Yep.
The board meetings and how those did not change.
Of course, if we need any other additional, we can add them later, right?
No. Yes, we can, Mr. Clement. Absolutely. Yeah, and we usually do that, so this is just those that we said.
All right.
So I ask for action.
Motion?
I move approval of the board vacation calendar for committees.
Second.
Motion second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Against? Motion carries. German American Partnership Programming Trip to Germany.
As board members, I'm going to turn this over to Alan to discuss this. This has been discussed in the committee more than one time, and Alan's here to share additional information about this and ask the board approval.
Thanks, Todd. You have in your packets a gap timeline for Seward High School. So Babette Timmerman went ahead and just showed you what the next 2 year cycle would look like, because she shared how it is like a cycle. First, the German students come here, and then eventually Seward students would go there. So that's all played out for you in detail, because there are so many details to prepare and get organized for it. So I'm not sure if you have any questions on that. Babette and Adam are both here also to assist you if you have any questions, or we're hoping that we take action on this particular decision.
Anyone have any questions?
I think we went through a lot of the questions both in the curriculum committee and then I think in the committee poll as well.
Yeah, Kyle, correct.
Well done. Good presentation.
Does anyone have a motion?
I move for approval.
I'll second that.
Motion and second. Any discussion?
I still can't. I praise you for all the changes from what we've previously seen, but the fact that we're still not doing any kind of a record check, and I would hope this is going to improve, I would hope that it is out there for parents front and center that that's not happening. But I can't support it. I understand, and I've been told, you know, it's not culturally the norm to do, but in the same countries, if it was an AFS student, there would be a background check for the family. And the fact that we're not doing that same when sending our students there, I can't support it. So I'll be voting against it.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Against?
Nay.
Motion carries. Mr. Leach, nay. All right, moving on to CPAC contract renewal.
Annually, we ask the board to approve the CPAC contract. It's the same contract that has been approved previously. We just updated the dates. Every year we engage and we work with Kathy and make certain there's nothing changed as far as the agreement between the school district and CPAC, and there have been no changes. So I'd ask the board to approve this contract.
Move to approve the contract.
Second. Motion second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Against? Curious. Have enough?
Yep. E, I think, is it?
Yeah, exactly.
Approval of the CISA-6 contract. Anyway, this is done as well. I'll ask Kristen and Lena.
Yep, you've seen this contract before. It comes due yearly. Previously, it was always for our membership in the Title II ELL network for support services and our website hosting. We've added to this contract this year our EduVision video portal solution. If you've been able to view Webster's video announcements from the media room, that was funded by a CEF grant. That's where we host all the videos for the video announcements and any other productions. So nothing new other than that, but just bringing this part of the people of the contract.
You know, everyone's moved up.
Second.
Motion second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
one contract for the 17-18 school year. I'll ask Ted to speak to that.
And this is our annual contract. You've seen the identical one last year and the year before. Services have remained flat. Much of the services that we pay for special education related need students and their IEPs. And those do vary throughout the school year, but basically this is the starting point we go from and then and/or subtract as the year goes on for student needs.
Motion move to approve.
Second.
Motion second, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Against? Motion carries.
Excellent. Item G. We're asking the board to approve the preliminary budget for the 17-18 school year. There's been plenty of discussion, plenty of work of Ben and PNF to get to this point, and I'll turn it over to Ben to give some background information.
So this budget proposal is coming as a recommendation from the PNF committee. There's two attachments in board docs that break down the budget based on the recommended format from the state, and there's also one that's more of a summary that breaks down by line item for some of the larger items that you've seen before. So some of the main highlights from there, we work some of the line items to kind of work with what with demands we have for next year and also some changes we had looking at 17-18. It's a balanced budget overall based on a $200 per pupil from the state. If that changes, obviously we'll have to work within that. But we gave ourselves some flexibility in terms of setting aside $200,000 for a deposit into our Fund 46 account, which is long-term capital improvement planning. So getting the ball rolling there to start planning long-term. And then there's two commitments to fund balance from the water line system at West Lawn and then the LED light project, the second part of that, finishing up in 2018. This also presents a flat or a 0% increase to the tax levy in 17-18. Obviously, there's still a lot of factors that influence that as we work into the fall with property values coming in, enrollments, and whatnot. So we'll keep an eye on that in terms of where that finishes. But overall, we're in a good position for next year financially, I would say.
All right, I know we've been a lot of talk on this along the way, and we'll continue. We've gone over in great detail in the PNF. And we have a motion.
We got a question. I'm just wondering, looking at the, and I probably missed the last PNF meeting, but the April summary showed the LED project was a $600,000 number, and now it's $400,000.
Yep, that's mainly due to the fact that we spent $800,000 in 16-17, so that number got adjusted.
Oh, okay, so it's been, we already paid that. So
right,
okay.
Yeah, John, right. A little crazy this year, so.
You were below overtime.
Right.
Jack the budget up a different way.
Right.
And those a lot of the dumpsters were overfilled at Webster when
right. So you stay pretty busy, so yeah. So that's the main reason why. So the total amount of it is still $1.2 million. So we're already starting to see some savings from the utility costs that we're seeing in the spring. So yeah.
And then that savings gets put into a fund?
Yep, yeah. So when the board initially approved that, the plan was to take those savings and start putting it back into fund balance to build it back. So.
Great. Okay. Any other questions? Any discussion? Any motion?
I move approval of the 2017-2018 preliminary budget as presented.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Against?
Nay.
Motion passes with Mr. Beach. Nay. All right. Item H, food service contract.
Yes, this again is part of the annual process. At the PNF meeting, we discussed the contract and food services, and we were treated to some wonderful food items during the PNF meeting, which was exciting, and we enjoyed those during our conversation.
I didn't hear about
that. Yep.
You need to come to the meetings.
Yeah, we're ready.
It was starting to stay home.
And so I'll ask Ben to speak to this. I see Laura's in the audience there. Thank you for coming up.
Yep, so we're looking for a renewal with service with Aramark for the 17-18 school year. The increase we're looking at for Aramark is an 8% increase, and there's multiple pieces that are a part of that. Overall, it had a fiscal impact of about $54,000 to the district, with a portion of that being for improving the quality of food in our district for students. And it's also there's also another part of that due to the inflationary increase for our annual rates. And the last piece is to increase hourly staff, hourly rates for staff to prevent further turnover in the department. So overall, we put this proposal together to really improve the program as a whole. As you guys already know, the food service fund balance is very high, and each year the state recommends that we have a spend-off plan put in place to start working our way down to get something that's a little bit closer to our 3 months of operating expenses. And so this was part of that plan to start working on down on that total amount, and we thought it was a nice way to put it back into the program to improve the quality of service for our students. So
part of Laura's plan is maybe to expand a little bit what you said is so students aren't getting shut down at stations because of lack of staffing.
Yeah, so this last fall we had an issue where we had staff turnover, there wasn't enough staff, and we had to shut down certain stations at the high school just so we could cover everything else. So we really want to avoid that in the future, and we think the higher salary, hourly rates will kind of help with that. So,
good.
I move approval of the food service contract.
Second.
Motion in second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Against? Motion carries. And aye. Energy Efficiency Commission.
Yes, this has been brought to the board a few times, and now we are at the point where we're making final approvals, and I'm asking for the approval of the resolution specific to the energy efficiency exemption. You can see the dollar amount in there. Ben has some additional information just received today that he'll share actually on the next two items as well.
Yep, so this is a revised resolution, mainly in place because we got our final sale of our notes today. So they set the debt payment schedules, we have final numbers for that. So really it's just updating all those numbers and putting firm numbers for the entire schedule and the final amount that we're planning to borrow, which is just under $5 million, so it's not the full amount. So it's a revised version of what we looked at last month.
Maybe just to be clear, that's $4.965 million.
Yep. And I'll get into that a little bit more in the next agenda item.
All right.
I'm going to approve the resolution authorizing $4,965,000.
I'll second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Against? Motion carries. And Jay.
All right, so the next agenda item actually is the borrow of the note. So it's the official resolution to take on these notes. Good news overall, we were projecting a 3% interest rate for our 10-year borrow, and the rate came at 2.14, so a lot lower than what we were expecting. Overall savings would, on interest costs, would be about 27% overall for the total cost. So the district will say, or the community will save about $300,000 over the 10 years in interest costs from what was originally projected. So that's good news overall. I attached the debt schedule into the board docs for you to review, just so you can see the 10-year schedule for it. As we talked about before, it's tiered to work with our current existing debt. So there's no tax increase from year to year. We can work it within our current threshold that we have to make sure there's no uptick in the tax levy. And overall, like I said, the biggest piece of good news is just the interest rate that came in.
Great.
A little bit lower than we were.
So. I commend you and your team who could do this process. It's really innovative and a smart way to do this, to go about this. Nice job. The interest rate is just unbelievable.
And I would add that if we, now that we're able to start putting money away for capital improvements, we might get in a position down the road we're going to do. Even to do this, it's going to be even better.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
Definitely. And I think that what this whole thing was intended to do by the legislature, you guys completely did it to a T. I know there was talk about other municipalities or school districts and everything. using it and in other projects. This is definitely energy efficient, you know, replacing units from the 60s. Again, you know, stuff that Kevin Kennedy used when he was here as a child. So. Yeah.
Still being a coal furnace.
Right. But it's fantastic. So. Yeah. Great job.
John's been instrumental in moving us forward. He's not here tonight because he's home sleeping. He's so exhausted from dealing with this room.
Oh,
it's quite enough. But we do want to recognize John because he was working with Ben and bring us forward. Yeah.
Won't go wrong.
Second.
Motion in a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Against? Motion carries unanimously. All right, item K. Policies.
J, I think.
Okay.
We're just asking the board to approve the policies under item K. I think to be waived second reading. These were policies that were brought to the committee before, to the 3310 and 4310. Those in addition to the policy committee reviewed and added, and then in addition to their urgent ones based on some new legislation.
And the committee was unanimous in recommending the waiving of the second reading and approving. So I'll move to approve.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Can I make one comment? But I think the name is wrong on the agenda. The first two that's listed as freedom of speech. We actually titled them employee expression, I believe.
Correct. We'll make that change.
Yeah.
Can we just vote on that one more time if that changed?
Yes.
Is that okay?
Yes. Yep.
For the first and second?
Yep.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Against? Motion carries. Item L, action to approve name change, Webster Transitional School, Webster Middle School. We have met on this as well in the copy.
Yep, this is a big decision here, board members, to go from Webster Transitional School to Webster Middle School. Tony Gross, the principal, made a presentation over a month ago to the board. A lot of that information is in the background piece that's in the board docs. We're asking the board to approve that name change to start with this coming school year.
Move approval?
Second. All right. I have a question. Does Milwaukee Public School still have a Webster?
They do. It's in the newspaper.
That's what it does. So are we going to have a map ready at the school for when people show up to the wrong school? Because wasn't that an issue years and years ago where there was conflict? Anybody? Oh, I see nothing yet. Okay. I thought somebody told me that years ago there was an issue where people get the two schools confused. Show up at the wrong school when they, you know, look for it.
I think there's like, you know,
several.
Yeah, John F. Kennedy Middle School.
Probably 100 of them.
But you're right. I mean, there is one because it was just in the newspaper that came out ago. I remember reading about Webster. I'll put that right away. It was not our question.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Against? Motion carries. Would anyone from the public like to speak at this time on any topic whatsoever? Anyone want to speak on anything at all? Come down.
I could comment on the.
Excuse me, I just have to read something first.
Okay. So you can talk to the podium.
When I'm done, you might not want to talk. In past, the State Attorney General issued guidance on how governmental bodies such as school boards should conduct the public comment portions of their meetings. This guidance was given to assist governmental bodies in avoiding violations of the state's open meeting laws. The essence of this guidance is that unless the topic being brought to the board by the public is listed on that meeting's agenda, no significant discussion can be held on that item. Instead, the topic may be listed as an item on a future meeting agenda, whereby discussion could then be held. The reason for this guidance is not to limit open discussion, but rather to ensure that all interested parties have equal opportunity to participate in the discussions with this full school board. We on the school board encourage community input, and we want to hear from you, our constituents. However, we also take the state's open meeting law seriously and will follow the guidance as outlined by the State Attorney General. Therefore, if an item is listed on tonight's agenda, open dialogue may occur between the individual from the public and the board members. If it is not listed, the board will be limited to listen and will not be able to respond to comments or questions. If your item is not listed on tonight's agenda and you wish to have a discussion regarding the topic, you are encouraged to contact the district superintendent and request that your item be listed on a future meeting agenda. As always, you are encouraged to discuss any issue with individual board members on a one-on-one basis outside the meeting setting. Please make your comments to the board, not to individuals in the audience. Please note, this is a public meeting, and we ask everyone to address one another with courtesy and respect. We'd like to receive in return. Please step up to the microphone, state your name and address for the record, and as a reminder, you are on the YouTube channel.
You still here?
You still want to talk? I don't
know. My name is Alvin Sprimey. I am actually a Grafton resident, and my son attends West Lawn Elementary School Choice Program, so he's moving to eighth grade. I'd like to comment on the point you brought up earlier about trying to implement some of these aspects of new engineering curriculum change sooner than later. Obviously, when it involves official curriculum, that's a problem that it goes through our procedure we need to go through. However, in speaking with some of the other fathers at the Dolphins Dad Club that has the children or students, I think there are some things that could be done on an extracurricular basis. And we had talked about trying to develop through the fathers in the club or some presentations, whether it's a Friday after school, Saturday morning type of thing, to start introducing students to some of these concepts. As you mentioned, teach them that 2x4s and 1.5 square by 1.5 by 3. Katie has just indicated to me that the facilities for the makerspace will actually be moving into the testing facilities in the library, so they will actually have a closed room where they perhaps can make a little bit more noise than they could in the open area. And I think that would represent a good opportunity to try out some of these, let's say, just introductory concept type things, as you mentioned, whether it's shorter curriculum. One of my favorites is the introduction to tools. We have heard Tim Toolman Taylor, but I've got him beat. And it's the type of thing that I think that it would be of interest, and I think that it would be done correctly, address some of the issues that we saw in the gender gap between the students. I have talked with some of the ladies who are tradespersons. Perhaps some of you may know her at Home Depot, the electrician in Aspen, and she has agreed to actually do some of these talks. So that it's, I think there's this miscommunication, misunderstanding of the parts of what they are. One of the fathers, who's a father of four daughters, tells me his daughters can change their brakes on his truck. And so I think that there's some of those types of things that you could do on an extracurricular basis, at least as an introductory thing, try to get some of the feedback that may also be useful in terms of how things would be done in a curriculum basis as well. So I would do one of the limitations here.
We can talk about this.
Yeah.
So, I think it's a great idea. I think I would ask if you could include the other elementaries as well, if they don't have
the idea. Absolutely, because we're going to strive to do this, that we need to, not to do it once and then have it repeat, right, but to actually, yes, try to include it. I mean, I guess what I took out of this here was that West Lawn is sort of taking the lead on the makerspace, and that would be one area with a lot of these things that could try to come into. And without getting into official curriculum changes and things like that, and I think there would be some willingness, certainly on people's part, for donations of some basic types of tools, equipment, and things like that, obviously on the safe side, to try to get it started. And that could be a process that then could be reviewed at the other schools to see how they're moving in that direction.
I know a lot of students are looking for volunteer hours, and I think if you could somehow incorporate them into your...
Don't get me started. But I think that one of the main things here would be in terms of having the high school students in these areas actually working to develop projects that then filter down to the elementary level. As And this is in terms of building scientific apparatus and mechanical mold movements and things like that, where we can start building a self-perpetuating cycle. I call it the pay it forward cycle, where the students from the high school levels, middle school levels, are working back down into the elementary school levels. I think it's going to take some of the initial burden off having to train teachers into some of these areas. The middle school project lead the way. It has a very nice laboratory of people doing stuff like that. And if those types of students, what they learn there, could easily bring some of those concepts right back down into the elementary from those levels.
Yeah. I think Alan would be your contact for that.
Yeah, Alan gets a lot of emails. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Anyone else? I won't read that again.
Yeah, let me beautify it.
Right, trying to go fast. All right. Committee reports. Enough, I know we talked about this stuff that was on the agenda that we already voted on, but.
We went over the budget, contract with Airmark. Another piece we looked at was just the overall district plan that we currently own, and then also 149 that's currently used for to pay off a larger project we have with the Pollution Club. So we just had a discussion on that. We'll do those details. So,
First of all, we had a great food service presentation by Laura and her team, very innovative, forward-thinking food service for our students, so thanks for that. We definitely ate well. Ben Davis, the enrollment numbers, which we talked about earlier, and some projections. We talked about those budget amendments that we voted on earlier, and obviously thought that was a good idea, and waiving an online user fees for our students.
Great.
All right, B&G Committee. I can touch base on that, I guess, so Ben can add to it. We did get proposals from a number of firms. We have interviews coming up.
Is it next week?
So that we're going to start interviewing various firms to bring a recommendation forward to the whole board.
Excellent. All right, and then Policy Committee, I know you guys just...
You just approved those, and it was our shortest policy committee ever.
What's next? It is time to redo them all. Can I say?
Certainly, that's 20 seconds.
Start over.
Yes, it's starting right. Over.
Wow. Thanks for all your hard work on that. Yeah, that was a arduous task. This time I'll take a motion to adjourn into the executive session where we will approve the minutes and consider compensation performance pursuant to 19.851C, Wisconsin statutes, and public business with competitive bargaining implications pursuant to 19.851E of Wisconsin statutes. This time I'll take that motion.
Move to adjourn into closed session. Second.
Motion second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Against?